Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and their page numbers in Chennai, Delhi, Bengaluru, Trivandrum and Hyderabad editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping of the displayed articles are provided in the description box, and for the benefit of mobile phone viewers, the timestamping is also provided in the comment section. Even today, as we discuss and analyze the news articles, the practice questions will be displayed. You may comment the answers of the questions in the comment section. The answers with solutions will be available in the description of tomorrow's The Hindu News Analysis video. Now let us move on to the analysis of first news article. This news article is based on the Crime in India statistics of 2017 that has been recently released by the National Crime Records Bureau. The syllabus relevant to the analysis has been highlighted here for your reference. See, the National Crime Records Bureau comes under the Ministry of Home Affairs. It releases three important publications or reports. One is the Prison Statistics of India, then Crime in India Statistics, and finally Accidental Deaths and Suicides in India. Usually by the June of next year, they will release the Crime in India Statistics of the previous year. That is, on usual terms, this statistics that is released yesterday should have been actually released by June 2018. But we are seeing a delay of more than a year in publishing this Crime in India statistics of 2017. See, this Crime in India statistics is the official statistics from the Government of India with respect to the offenses under various categories registered all across the country. Delay in releasing such a report is similar to delaying the justice. This is because the more the delay, the more manipulation it could have undergone. That is one side of the story, but at times there may be reasons because of administrative delays in collecting and compiling the data. These things also at times become difficult. Now, this report for a year usually consists of information with respect to offenses under various categories. Offenses under registered under Indian Penal Code, crimes against women, crimes against children, crimes against senior citizens, crimes against the persons belonging to scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. All right. And they also include economic offenses, corruption offenses, crimes committed by anti-national elements, crimes in railways, and also offenses related to environment. Now that NCRB just compiles and collates the data on crimes, actually they are collected from or obtained from the police authorities of state governments and union territories, and also from central law enforcement agencies, central police organizations and central armed police forces. Now let us see few important matter that has come in our news article based on this report. One is about the rate of total cognizable offenses that has occurred in India in 2017. Here, when we say cognizable offenses, these are offenses in which a police officer may arrest a person without a warrant. This is according to Section 2C of Code of Criminal Procedure. These offenses are generally serious in nature, say for example, murder or kidnapping. Know that the rate of total cognizable crime is calculated for 1 lakh of population for statistical purposes. That is, the crime rate means the number of cases reported for 1 lakh of population. See, according to the report, Delhi has the highest crime rate in India with 1050 crimes committed per lakh of the population. And Nagaland has recorded the lowest crime rate in India with 44 crimes for 1 lakh of the population. Next, let's see a few information about the crime against women. So according to the official statistics, the incidence and cases of crime against women has increased when compared to 2016 or 2015. So this marks an increasing trend in crimes against women. UP tops in the list of crimes against women, followed by Maharashtra and West Bengal. And the news article mentions that majority of the cases of crime against women were reported with respect to cruelty by husband or his relatives. That means there is a severe inter-partner violence, or there could be violence by the family of the partner. Here the partner is male, and assault on women with intent to outrage her modesty, and then sexual assault. The news article also talks about the crime incidents that are registered under the Prevention of Atrocities Against the Scheduled Caste and the Scheduled Tribes Act of 1989. There is increase in the atrocities against the persons belonging to scheduled castes from 2016. However, news article mentions that the offenses against persons belonging to scheduled tribes have decreased from 2016. One important fact with respect to this report of 2017 is that for the first time, NCRB has collected data on the circulation of false news or fake news and rumors. Under this category, maximum incidents were reported from Madhya Pradesh, then Uttar Pradesh and Kerala. We will be receiving news and editorials on various chapters of offenses, say for example crime against children, in the days to come, as and when we will discuss the articles in our analysis. And with respect to these reports, we have to know that these reports only contain the reported data or the cases for which a first information report has been filed. This means most of the offenses that are unreported are not reflected in this Crime in India statistics. So to know the real intensity or to know the ground picture, we require various victimization surveys, various other efforts to expose the various unreported offenses and crimes. With this, let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article is with respect to the recent meeting of Defence Acquisition Council and some of the outcomes of the meeting. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here for your reference. The news article mentions that the Defence Acquisition Council, which is chaired by Defence Minister, has approved three projects worth ₹3,300 crore. The author states that these three projects are with respect to the equipment that are to be indigenously designed and developed. Recently, on October 12, we discussed about the Defence Procurement Procedure of 2016 as a part of the shift towards indigenization of Indian defence sector. Now, these projects recently approved by DAC will also become the part of the shift. In this context, let us see few information about the Defence Acquisition Council. Now, this council was formed based on the recommendations given by the group of ministers on reforming the national security system. So it was formed in 2001 under the Ministry of Defence for overall guidance of defence procurement planning process. The main objective of Defence Acquisition Council is to ensure quick or expeditious procurement of the approved requirement of armed forces in terms of sought capabilities and in terms of time frame prescribed, and also by optimally utilizing the allocated budgetary resource. So this means that the council has to speed up the procurement process and complete it within the prescribed time limit so that there will be efficient decision making and also optimum utilization of resources. If you see the composition of this Defence Acquisition Council, the Union Defence Minister is the chairman. There are many members. We will see few important members. It will also have Minister of State for Defence, then chiefs of all three armed forces, Army, Navy and Air Force. Then it will have DRDO Secretary and Defence Secretary and few other members. Coming to functions of Defence Acquisition Council, it gives in principle approval to defence procurements in long-term integrated perspective plan. Here long-term refers to a period of 15-year time span. It also gives acceptance of necessity for acquisition proposals. That is, if a proposal is received, it has to state that such an acquisition is required and is necessary for India. And it also categorizes the acquisition proposals relating to the categories of buy and make and make. See, the Defence Procurement Procedure of 2016, it deals with the categories of make and buy. That is, making the required equipment or buying them. One another is buy and make. That is, you get the equipment, get the technology, then you make. Buy category is further classified as, you know, buy indigenously designed, developed and manufactured, buy Indian and buy global. Make category is further classified into make one and make two. Here, make two defense projects are industry funded, whereas make one defense projects are government funded. News article talks about make two category, we'll see that in the drag end of analysis of this news article. And this Defense Acquisition Council also decides on offset provisions in respect of acquisition proposals above rupees 2000 crore. Before 2016, this number was 300 crore. See, under offset provision, there will be 30% domestic value addition in India for those purchases that are above rupees 2000 crore. Then this council also decides regarding transfer of technology under buy and make category of acquisition proposals. And also it plays a very important role in field trial evaluation. Now let us come to this news article. We saw that DAC has approved three projects. So one of them is third generation anti-tank guided missiles. They are designed to hit and destroy the heavily armored military vehicles of enemy. And secondly, it includes auxiliary power units to act as backup power sources for T-72 and T-90 tanks of India. Then the third indigenous project is with respect to discrete electronic warfare systems for the mountain and high altitude terrain. These systems are called as electronic warfare system because they will have the ability to use electromagnetic spectrum to deal with signals such as radio, infrared or radar, so as to sense the signals and protect and to communicate. And they will be able to deny the adversaries or enemy who will try to disrupt or use these signals. News article mentions that some of the projects will be progressed under Make 2 category. This means it will be predominantly industry funded, not government funded. So according to news article, this is the first time that the Ministry of Defense has offered the design, development and manufacturing of complex military equipment to the Indian private industry. These are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to next article. This news article is about e-flow notification that is issued by the central government in 2018. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here for your reference. See, e-flow is nothing but environmental flow, or it is also called as ecological flow. When we say environmental flow, it means the flow of water that is in a river or wetland or a coastal zone that is required to maintain ecosystems and the benefits of the ecosystems. And these ecosystems are the areas where there will be competing water uses or competing water needs, and there may be also regulation of water flow. Maybe, for example, to divert water for irrigation purposes or for hydroelectric projects or for industries, etc. So in one way we can say ecological flow helps to allocate water among multiple and competing uses in a watershed or a river basin. At the same time, it also ensures maintenance of an ecosystem. In our context, ecological flow refers to the uninterrupted flows of water that are maintained throughout the length and at all times in River Ganga to ensure continuity of flows in the river without altering the seasonal variations. That is, whatever may be the seasonal variation, there has to be uninterrupted minimum flow in River Ganga. Overall, these flows, environmental flows or ecological flow in general terms, they help for integrated management of river flows to meet the needs of people, say agriculture, industries, energy, also for ecosystems, however managing within the limits of available supply. Here water may be required for agriculture, for the purposes of irrigation, for people, for drinking and other purposes, and for energy requirements, say hydroelectric projects, for industries, say water dependent industries also require water. At the same time, we have also maintained the river ecosystem. So by maintaining ecological uninterrupted minimum flow in a river, we will be able to sustain the functioning of an ecosystem and its dependent species, which also includes human beings and other species. So now let us discuss the ecological flow notification, which was issued by the central government in 2018. But there is an authority whose objective is to determine the magnitude of or the quantum of ecological flow in River Ganga and its tributaries that is required to be maintained at different points in different areas at all times. This authority is the National Mission for Clean Ganga, for rejuvenation, protection and management of River Ganga Basin. This authority comes under Ministry of Jal Shakti. We know about this National Mission of Clean Ganga since 2011 when it was registered as a society under Societies Registration Act of 1860. However, based on the notification by then Ministry of Water Resources, River Development and Ganga Rejuvenation, which was dated 7th October 2016, this National Mission of Clean Ganga became an authority constituted under the Environment Protection Act of 1986. Also know that National Mission for Clean Ganga is the nodal agency for nationwide implementation with respect to effective abatement of pollution and rejuvenation, protection, management of River Ganga and its tributaries. Now this authority, National Mission for Clean Ganga, comes under Ministry of Jal Shakti. The Ecological Flow Notification in 2018 stated that maintaining environmental flow or uninterrupted minimum flow was essential to ensure water quality and to ensure environmentally sustainable rejuvenation, protection and management of River Ganga and its tributaries. Know that if you read Section 3 and Section 5 of Environmental Protection Act of 1986, the central government can issue directions to any person or any officer or any authority to comply with the directions given under Environmental Protection Act. This power also includes the power to direct closure of an industry or to prohibit an operation, or the power also includes the power to regulate an industry or to stop or regulate the supply of electricity or water or any other service to such industry or such project. That is why the news article mentions that the hydropower projects that do not comply with center's ecological flow notification could face closure. So the notification in 2018 ensures minimum environmental flows at locations downstream of structures or at locations downstream of projects. These projects are meant to divert river flows for the purpose of irrigation, hydropower, domestic, industrial and for other requirements. Whatever may be the requirements, there has to be a minimum environmental flow at all times. The notification actually gave a time period of 3 years for the existing projects in River Ganga and its tributaries to ensure compliance to the mandated environmental flows. And under this notification, the Central Water Commission, which is now under Ministry of Jal Shakti, is the designated authority to ascertain the actual flow and the amount of water present in the river. And it shall submit flow monitoring compliance report on quarterly basis to National Mission for Clean Ganga. But this time period of 3 years to comply with has been advanced to December 2019. And one main reason mentioned in the news article is that authorities found that most of the projects along River Ganga and its tributaries were able to easily comply with the norms. For example, as of now, among 19 power projects along the river, 8 were fully compliant to this e-flow notification or the mandated environment flows. Now let us see the ecological flows mandated by the notification. Here we will see 3 seasons. One is the dry season, which is from November to March. Then the lean season, which is during October, April and May. Then the monsoon months of June to September. In dry season, there has to be 20% of monthly average flow. And this monthly average flow is that of preceding 10 days of the dry season. And 25% of the monthly average flow of the preceding 10 days during October, April and May. And 30% of monthly average during monsoon months of June to September. The notification also mentions minimum flow during monsoon period and non-monsoon period at few barrages, and these are Bhimgoda, Bijnor, Narora and Kanpur. See, Bhimgoda is in Uttarakhand, all the 3 other barrages are in Uttar Pradesh. Now the notification mandates a minimum supply of water shall be uninterrupted and throughout the year at all seasons. But it is found that the power projects, hydroelectric projects, they hoard water to create additional reserves to increase power generation. Hoarding here is a negative sense, as if they are not allowing environmental flows and are taking the water that are mandated to be under mandated environmental flows so as to increase the production and profit of the producers, however, at the cost of the ecosystem. As a result, in most cases, when it goes below the ecological flow, particularly in summer season, it adversely affects the river ecosystem and all other ecosystems that are dependent on the minimum environmental flow. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to next article. This news article states that Siachen now open for tourism. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here for your reference. We could see some important terms such as Siachen, Kumar Post, Shayok River in eastern Ladakh, Colonel Chawang Rinchen Setu, constructed by Border Roads Organization. We'll discuss these terms mostly in prelims perspective. See, as per the reorganization of Jammu and Kashmir, the Leh district and Kargil districts are parts of Union Territory of Ladakh. Now, the main fact is that after the reorganization of Jammu and Kashmir, Siachen is a part of Leh district of Union Territory of Ladakh. Know that Siachen is the world's highest battlefield because of its geographical location. See, the base camp of Siachen is about 11,000 feet altitude, and the Kumar Post in this Siachen region is at about an altitude of 15,000 feet. We could find a mention of Colonel Chawang Rinchen Setu. Setu here refers to bridge. This bridge was constructed by Border Roads Organization at an altitude of 14,650 feet in the forward area of Ladakh region. We call these areas forward area because the bridge is at around some 45 kilometer distance from the Indo-China border, from the border between India and China. And this bridge is said to be India's highest altitude all-weather permanent bridge that is expected to play a very important role in connectivity. The name of the bridge, Colonel Chawang Rinchen, he is called as Lion of Ladakh for his extraordinary acts of courage and valor, particularly in defending Leh and Partapur sectors in the 1971 Bangladeshi Liberation War, otherwise called as Indo-Pak War of 1971 by some sources. See, he was born in 1931 in Sumur village in Nubra Valley in Ladakh region. Now, in his name, the highest altitude all-weather permanent bridge of India is being named as a tribute. Note that this Rinchen Setu is constructed on Shayok River. This Shayok River is a tributary of Indus River system. This you can see in this diagram. You should also take note of important places, say for example, Sakskam Valley, Nubra Valley and Aksai Chin. Now we saw that this bridge, this Setu, will play a very important role in ensuring connectivity in Ladakh region, and it is by ensuring connectivity, it will also promote tourism, even adventure tourism. And the presence of the bridge in this region is also strategically important in maintaining peace and stability in this Ladakh region. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to next article. This editorial article is about China's growing influence and concomitant clout at the United Nations. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article has been highlighted here for your reference. The author discusses about some of the ways and means which was used by China and is being used by China to legitimize and spread its ideology and its own interests. One of the important news that was discussed with respect to United States in the global arena, particularly after 2016, is that USA is not actively participating in multilateral forums. Here, when we say multilateral forums, these are platforms that have members or contributors from multiple countries or many countries. And China is said to have exploiting the advantage because of which is the absence of US. The author also talks about China making use of this advantage not only in multilateral forums but also in UN peacekeeping force and also in United Nations Security Council. We know that UN Security Council is one of the six principal or six main organs of United Nations. It consists of five permanent members and 10 non-permanent members. And one of these five permanent members is China. The other members are United States, UK, France, and Russia. And China is using its clout or influence in this UN Security Council in getting more positions in the UN Secretariat hierarchy. In the course of the analysis, we'll see some of the positions that were leaded by Chinese men. On the other hand, if you see India, author states that India's role is largely limited to one demand, which is the support for the expansion of permanent membership of Security Council. Here, UN Secretariat is also one of the six main organs of UN. Then the author talks about the role of China in United Nations in the Cold War era and beyond, where the role of China is largely that of a disruptor, which means causing some disturbance or problems. In this, author means to say that since the formation of United Nations, liberal ideology and liberal visions are being brought to forefront by the Western democracies. Here, when we say liberal, means Western countries were more open to new ideas, whereas China was always against such liberal ideology. But today, China is trying to reverse the scenario where China is actively seeking to use this UN platforms to legitimize and spread its non-liberal and own ideology. One way by which China has sought to impose its viewpoints is by increasing its monetary contributions to the United Nations. The author mentions that China has increased its monetary contributions fivefold to the United Nations in last 10 years. Then the author mentions that China is projecting itself as a champion of multilateralism, particularly under the regime of the president of China, Xi Jinping. Again, this also coincides with the time when United States is pulling itself from several multilateral agreements and also engaging in trade wars. The author mentions that during last year, when the trade war between China and US is going on, Chinese president pushed China to take an active part in leading the reform of global governance system. Here, when we say global governance system, this may be with respect to World Trade Organizations or with respect to reform and quota system in International Monetary Fund or other entities in global governance. Thus, by leading the reforms in global governance, it projects itself as a champion of multilateralism. Then the author discusses about who are being appointed to head more than a quarter of United Nations specialized agencies from China. These are officials from Communist Party of China. Some of the organizations being headed by these Chinese Communist Party members include, say, Food and Agriculture Organization, UN Industrial Development Organization, an International Civil Aviation Organization, and also International Telecommunication Union. See, UN specialized agencies, they are legally independent international organizations having their own rules, their own membership, organs, and financial resources. They were related to United Nations through negotiated agreements. Some of the agencies existed before First World War. At that time, some agencies were associated with League of Nations. But after United Nations came into picture, they became associated with United Nations. And some agencies, which are called as specialized agencies, they were created simultaneously with the United Nations. And few agencies were created by UN itself to meet the newly emerging needs of the time. Then the author states that China has also increased its participation in United Nations peacekeeping forces to project its phase of aspiring peace in the world. It states to the countries that China is aiming to play a bigger role in peacekeeping operations. And China has also projected the soft power by including a contingent from its UN peacekeeping force in the military parade that happened to mark the 70th anniversary of the communist rule. And with respect to United Nations Security Council, it is not only using the influence to create positions in UN Secretariat or in UN hierarchy, but also it is taking advantage of lack of unity among the other permanent members of Security Council, particularly US, UK, and France. One of the most important things the author is worried about is the Chinese view on human rights. This is because the author is telling that China is pushing its ideology throughout UN by using United Nations Human Rights Council. At present, China is a member of United Nations Human Rights Council. Its term is to end by the end of this year. It has stressed that every country may choose its own human rights protection standards in the context of their own national circumstances. So this statement means that there will be no respect to the international human rights standards that are till now set by United Nations or other international organs. Rather, everything will be decided at the national level. So UN Human Rights Council is an intergovernmental body with the United Nations system. It's also called as a political body because the members are representatives of member nations. It is responsible for strengthening of protection and promotion of human rights around the world. And it is also responsible for addressing situations of human rights violations and also makes recommendations on them. And it also replaced the United Nations Commission on Human Rights. We know that it is made up of 47 United Nations member states that are elected by UN General Assembly. Right now, India is also a member since 1st January 2019. Recently, we also seen in newspapers that Venezuela has also been selected or elected to be a member of UNHRC in the future. And for it, the US have opposed because it feels that Venezuela do not have a significant human rights protection standards in its nation. And one of the criteria for the election of membership in this council is that those member countries that are to be elected should have good standards with respect to protection of human rights in their home territories. We have been seeing that USA has left several multilateral forums, and one such forum is UN Human Rights Council, where in 2018, United States has left in the middle of its time period because it alleged that UNHRC has anti-Israel view, that is, UNHRC unfavorably supports Palestine. But this has given a chance for China to dominate, to further its viewpoints with respect to human rights. The author is telling that as a result, China is diluting the concept of universal values with respect to human rights, and it promotes Chinese view on human rights. Then the author discusses about the track record of China and human rights by quoting a report of Human Rights Watch, which is an international non-governmental organization, works for the protection and promotion of human rights. In 2017, this NGO has exposed the China's efforts to silence the human rights experts in United Nations, and China has also prevented the critical disagreeing voices in China from participating in the United Nations processes. And China is also actively promoting its foreign policy initiatives through United Nations. The author mentions the example of Belt and Road Initiative. We know this initiative was proposed in 2013. It has Land Silk Road and a Maritime Silk Road. One of the Chinese national who is serving as United Nations Under Secretary General for Economic and Social Affairs has said that Belt and Road Initiative serves the purposes and principles of Charter of United Nations. By this, they are projecting a viewpoint that China's BRI initiative is in line with the United Nations policies. This is one example where the author mentions that China is trying to impose its initiatives, its interests through United Nations systems by ensuring its officials in the higher levels of UN Secretariat or UN's associated and specialized agencies. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this editorial article. We saw about some of the ways and means in which China is reinforcing its clout in United Nations and also as a champion of multilateralism. We also saw how it projects its viewpoint with respect to human rights in this article. Now let us move on to next article. These news articles are based on the elections that were held in the state of Haryana and Maharashtra for the state legislative assembly. And these articles also talk about by-elections that have took place in around 11 states in India and also in the Union Territory of Puducherry. The main important point here we have to notice, the voter turnout has decreased in Maharashtra and Haryana if we compare the numbers with the year 2014. While it was around 63% in 2014, now it has come to around 59% in Maharashtra, and while it was 76% in Haryana in 2014, it has come down to around 65.5%, with Gurugram in Haryana registering the lowest voter turnout in yesterday's elections. It was around 52.5 only. Know that voter turnout is an important indicator that gives an idea about people participation in the election in our democracy. Here in Maharashtra and Haryana, it has gone down. The newspaper also talks about lower voter turnout in the state of Kerala. Here in Kerala, by-elections have held in around 5 locations. In all these 5 places, there were low voter turnout. Here the reason is because of the weather. Particularly in Ernakulam, because of the continuous rainfall in the morning, the turnout was just around 57%, while in 2016 assembly elections, it was around 71.6% in the same assembly constituency. One of the news articles also talk about an issue that is reported to have happened in Asand in Haryana. A video was released wherein it is reported that a candidate has said that he has tampered with the electronic voting machine so that whoever votes, the vote will be registered to his party only. The matter is under investigation by the Election Commission and various other relevant authorities. The news article also talks about the cash, the liquor and the narcotic drugs and other illegal things that were seized during recent days in Maharashtra and Haryana. In Maharashtra, they have seized these things worth 156.94 crore and whereas in Haryana it was around 24.17 crore. This means bribe for voting still plays a major role in these states so as to manipulate the voting process by giving bribes to the people. Therefore, it becomes a threat to the democracy. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of these articles. This news article is based on the report that was released by the Credit Suisse Research Institute. This report is called as the Global Wealth Report 2019. See, Credit Suisse is one of the largest banks in Switzerland. It is also a universal bank that is engaged in almost all types of banking business in many parts of the world. It has an in-house think tank. This think tank is called as the Credit Suisse Research Institute. It is this research institute which releases the Global Wealth Report of 2019. We should note that usually in prelims, there will be some question with respect to indices or reports. There have been previously questions with respect to Rule of Law Index, Global Hunger Index, and then Global Financial Stability Report. All these things have been previously asked. So in this context, you have to know who releases this report. This Global Wealth Report is being said as the most comprehensive and up-to-date source for the information on global household wealth. As a result, it has become a standard reference point so as to monitor wealth growth across countries and also to monitor the extent to which wealth inequalities are widening or narrowing in the countries. This report states that India's wealth has trended upward strongly since the turn of the century, though there was a setback in 2008 because of the global financial crisis. See, the total wealth in India is $12.6 trillion. A news article mentions that the wealth in India has increased four times or fourfold between 2000 and 2019. The report states that for the past decade, the global wealth creation has centered around two countries, China and the United States. One of the most important points from this report with respect to our country that you can utilize in your essay writing or in mains under the syllabus Inclusive Growth is that while growth has been rising in India, not everyone has shared in this growth. That is, there is growth, but it is not shared among the populations. There is still considerable wealth poverty. Around 78% of the adult population in India has wealth below $10,000. That is, somehow below 7.1 lakhs. Of the global household wealth, India's proportion stands at 3.49%, whereas Chinese proportion stands almost four times Indian proportion, that is around 17.7%. And know that the top 10% of the adults in the world, they possess 82% of global wealth. That means 90% of adults in the world possess only 18% of global wealth. So these are some of the information with respect to the analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to next article. This news article is with respect to Kartarpur corridor. The article states that tomorrow a memorandum of understanding or an agreement to give effect so that the pilgrims from India can visit the Gurdwara Darbar Sahib in Kartarpur. However, one of the most important concern from Indian side in this regard is with respect to the service fee that is demanded from Pakistan side for one pilgrim for a single visit. They are claiming to collect a service fee of about $20, roughly around rupees 1,400. Indian government is continuously stressing and urging the Pakistan side to allow Indian pilgrims for free without any payment of fee to visit the final resting place of Sri Guru Nanak Dev Ji. Now we know that Kartarpur corridor connects two important Sikh shrines on either side of the border. That is, it connects Dera Baba Nanak Shrine in Gurdaspur in Indian side and Gurudwara Darbar Sahib in Kartarpur in Pakistan side. Know that the corridor is being built by both nations to commemorate the 550th birth anniversary of the founder of Sikh religion or Sikhism, which is to be celebrated on November 12. The press release from Ministry of External Affairs states that the pilgrims from India and those holding overseas citizen of India card, they can undertake visit to the Holy Gurdwara Kartarpur Sahib in Pakistan. And it is expected that on November 9 of this year, the first group of around 550 pilgrims will be visiting Kartarpur corridor. And on the same day, the land port, which we have discussed some days earlier with respect to Land Ports Act of India, which is the integrated check post, will also be inaugurated by the Indian Prime Minister. And among the visitors, the Punjab Chief Minister will also be one of the first visitors to the Kartarpur Shrine. These are some of the information that you can take from this news article. More news on this corridor and the agreements will be available on day after tomorrow. Now, for the practice questions that are displayed here with respect to the articles that I've discussed so far, the answers for these questions will be available in the description of tomorrow's video. For the practice questions that were displayed yesterday's The Hindu News Analysis, that are available as a PDF given through a link in the description of today's video. The same link has also been given in the comment section. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, comment, share and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation.